الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمد الشاكرين، وأفضل الصلاة وأكمل السلام على سيد المرسلين، قائد الغر المحجلين، نبي الحرمين، إمام القبلتين، وسيلتنا في الدارين، صاحب قاب قوسين، محبوب رب المشرقين والمغربين، جد الحسن والحسين، مولانا ومولى الثقلين، سيدنا ومولانا وملجأنا ومأوانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أصحابه أجمعين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ووالد وما ولد، صدق الله مولانا العظيم. My respected and honorable brothers, بحمدالله تعالى وبفضله, I have had the honor and the privilege of reciting a verse from the Al-Quran al-Kareem, from Surah Al-Balad, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an oath upon the forefathers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in today's brief lecture, I will be speaking in regards to the iman of the walidain, karimain, طيبين طاهرين مطهرين جميلين سعيدين منورين مسلمين مؤمنين موحدين جنتين of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I will be speaking in regard to the iman of the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, their honor, their nobility, and their purity. But before I begin, I would like for us to take into account on a foundational level that anything which has a link in light of the Quran and Hadith, anything which has a link to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that thing then becomes greater in essence. It becomes unique in comparison to all other things. It becomes distinct. This is such a mas'ala that no Muslim who reads the kalima would reject. Generally speaking, when no disrespect is intended, when something touches Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when something becomes attached to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that thing then becomes greater in essence. It becomes distinct. It becomes unique in comparison to all other things. When something acquires a nisbah with Rasulullah, when something becomes mansoob to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that thing then becomes mu'azzaz. It becomes mukarram. It becomes muhtaram. And this is such an established reality, which is proven from Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he begins Surah Al-Balad by taking a note. He says, La uqsimu bihadha al-balad. I swear by this city. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swear by the city of Makkah? This is the question which arises, or which should arise. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take an oath by the city of Makkah? It could have been possible that the people of Makkah, they could have attributed something towards themselves, that maybe we have such and such a thing, and because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken an oath in Makkah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he rid the upcoming confusion by answering himself as to why he takes an oath in Makkah. He did not take an oath in Makkah because of the Kaaba. He did not take an oath in Makkah because of the Hajr al-Aswad. He did not take an oath in Makkah because of the Hatim and Maqam Ibrahim. He did not take an oath in Makkah because of the well of Zamzam. He did not take an oath in Makkah because of Mina and Muzdalifa. He did not take an oath in Makkah because of Safa and Marwa. He did not take an oath in Makkah because it is a city of Tilawa. He did not take an oath in Makkah because it is a city of Tijara. He did not take an oath in Makkah because it is a city of Ibadah. He did not take an oath in Makkah because of the Baytul Haram. He did not take an oath in Makkah because of Masjidul Haram. He did not take an oath in Makkah because it is a place of Rukn and Maqam. He did not take an oath in Makkah because of Tawaf al-Istilam. He says, وَعَنْتَ هِلُّ بِهَذَا الْبَلَدِ. And it is you who reside in this city, Ya Rasulullah. It is because of you, Ya Rasulullah. This is وَوْحَالِيَا إِلَّةِ حَالِيَا. This is an illah for the maqabal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken an oath in Makkah because of the residence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is these winds that your words flow within. It is this breeze that embraces your body. It is the particles on the ground that kiss your feet. Ya Rasulullah, it is you who walks between these alleys. This is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an oath in the city of Makkah al-Mukarramah. So when something becomes linked to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it becomes so distinct, so amazing, so significant, that even Allah begins to take oath upon those things. And it is a principle that an oath be taken upon something which holds great significance. Like we take an oath on Allah. We take an oath on the sifat of Allah. We take an oath on the kalam of Allah. And we do not take oaths over minor matters but major matters. So then imagine the significance of that upon which Allah takes an oath. So it's evident that when something becomes linked to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, its ranks become elevated. It becomes unquestionable. It becomes matchless. Whether it be a stick or a stone, whether it be a human or an animal, once linked to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it becomes unique in comparison to everything else within its jins. It becomes unique in comparison to everything else of its life. There is no wind like the wind which embraced the body of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is no water like the water which kissed the body of Rasulullah. There is no ground like the ground that he walked upon. There is no soil like the soil that he stepped upon. There are no clothes like the clothes of Rasulullah. There are no sandals like the sandals of Rasulullah. There are no animals like the animals which he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mounted upon. There are no women like the women of Rasulullah. There are no ashab like the ashab of Rasulullah. There are no men like the men of Rasulullah. There is no Abu Bakr like the Abu Bakr of Rasulullah. There is no Umar like the Umar of Rasulullah. There is no Uthman like the Uthman of Rasulullah. There is no Ali like the Ali of Rasulullah. There is no Muawiyah like the Muawiyah of Rasulullah. There is no Khalid like the Khalid of Rasulullah. There is no Amr like the Amr of Rasulullah. There is no Hamza like the Hamza of Rasulullah. There are no children like the children of Rasulullah. There is no family like the family of Rasulullah. There is no Fatima like the Fatima of Rasulullah. There is no Hussein like the Hussein of Rasulullah. There is no Hassan like the Hassan of Rasulullah. There is no Zain al-Abidin like the Zain al-Abidin of Rasulullah. There is no Taqi like the Taqi of Rasulullah. There is no Naqi like the Naqi of Rasulullah. There is no Ja'far like the Ja'far of Rasulullah. There is no Musa like the Musa of Rasulullah. There is no Abdul Qadir like the Abdul Qadir of Rasulullah. And there is no Ummah like the Ummah of Rasulullah. There are no Ushaq like the Ushaq of Rasulullah. There is no Baba Farid like the Baba Farid of Rasulullah. There is no Ganjay Baksh like the Ganjay Baksh of Rasulullah. There is no Khaja like the Khaja of Rasulullah. There is no Suyuti like the Suyuti of Rasulullah. There is no Ghazali like the Ghazali of Rasulullah. There is no Imam Ahmad Raza like the Ahmad Raza of Rasulullah. There is no Abdullah like the Abdullah of Rasulullah. There is no Father like the Father of Rasulullah. And there is no Amina. There is no Mother like the Mother of Rasulullah.
Allahu
Akbar.
Ya Rasulullah.
Ya Ali.
So when something acquires a link to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is the aqidah of the Ahlu Sunnati wal Jama'ah. That when something acquires a link to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is a means of its ranks becoming elevated. What do you think? If water touches Rasulullah, if clothes touch Rasulullah, if a rock touches Rasulullah, if water touches Rasulullah, it is within a matter of a moment, within a blink of an eye, that its ranks become elevated. Then what would you say about that mother who carried Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam within her womb for 9 months? 1400 years have passed, and if you open the Quran today and forever, you will find that Allah takes an oath upon those alleys in which he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam walked in. He takes an oath upon those land which he walked upon the ground that he walked upon. Why? Because of his presence upon that land, because of his presence within those alleys. Then what about that mother in whose womb was the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for 9 months? That mother would pick Rasulullah and place him by her chest. That mother would feed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam milk. That mother would kiss Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What would be the maqam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given her? What would be the maqam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given her? These are such things which hadith and Quran prove, riwayat and dalail prove, naqal and aql prove. When something becomes attached to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is a means of his destiny changing. Within the Quran, Surah Yusuf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he speaks about Sayyidina Ya'qub alayhi salam. He cries and he cries and he cries and he cries until he becomes blind. Due to the departure of his son, due to being separated from his son, Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَبْيَضَّتْ عَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْحُزْنِ. His eyes became white due to sorrow. He became blind due to being separated from his son Yusuf alayhi salam. And if you continue on reading, when Yusuf alayhi salam, he finds out about the condition of his father, he takes off his shirt, he gives it to his brothers, and he says, اِذْهَبُوا بِقَمِيسِ هَذَا. Take this shirt of mine, فَأَلْقُوهُ عَلَىٰ وَجْهِ أَبِي, and place it on the face of my father, يَأْتِ بَصِيرًا. His eyesight will be restored. So my respected brothers, this is the maqam of that which touched the body of Yusuf alayhi salam, that it cured his father Sayyidina Yaqub alayhi salam, then what will be the rank of that which touches the aqa of Yusuf alayhi salam, Sayyidul Anbiya, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The mufassirun and the muhaddithun of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah all have an agreement that the forefathers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are mu'min, they are muwahid, they are Muslim, they are jannati. In fact, it is our belief that from Sayyiduna Abdullah radiyallahu anhu and Sayyidatuna Amina radiyallahu anha all the way up to Adam alayhi salam and Sayyidatuna Hawa radiyallahu anha, all the forefathers in between, all those loins through which he traveled, all those wounds through which he traveled, all those loins are pure. All those wounds are pure. They are all sajideen, they are all mu'mineen, they are all muslimin, and they are all jannati. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَوَالِدٌ وَمَا وَلَدٌ. Allah takes an oath by the walid and the mawlud. The Bayhaqi of the time, Allama Qadi Sana'ullah rahimahullah, he mentions in his tafsir madhari, مَا الْمُرَادِ بالوالد. What is meant by the term walid? He answers. He says, المراد بالوالد آدم وإبراهيم عليهما السلام. That by the term walid, Adam عليه السلام and Ibrahim عليه السلام are mentioned. And then he goes on to say, or this could be a reference to all the forefathers till the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if this is the rank of the father of al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then what will be the rank of his mother Sayyidatuna Amina radiyallahu ta'ala anha? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْعَزِيزِ الرَّحِيمِ. Have faith in Allah, the Almighty, the Most Merciful. الَّذِي يَرَاكَ حِينَ تَقُومِ. He who sees you when you stand. وَتَقَلُّبَكَ فِي السَّاجِدِينَ. He who sees your movements amongst the sajideen. This is not something new. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been watching the movements of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam since he's been traveling from loin to loin, womb to womb. Sayyiduna Imam Fakhruddin Razi rahimahullah, what is his understanding of وَتَقَلُّبَكَ فِي السَّاجِدِينَ, seeing his movements amongst the sajideen? He says, كَانَ يَنْقُلُ نُورَهُ مِنْ سَاجِدٍ إِلَى سَاجِدٍ. That the nur of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala transferred the nur of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the womb and the loins of one sajid to the womb and the loin of another sajid, a prostrator. He says, دَلَالَةً. This is an evidence. عَلَى جَمِيعِ آبَاءِ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَانُوا مُسْلِمِينَ. That they are all believers. All the forefathers of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, they are believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by using the term sajideen, he made it clear. The term sajid means one who prostrates to Allah. So all those wombs through which he traveled, all those loins through which he traveled, all those mothers, all those fathers, they are all sajideen. They are not mushrikeen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. And in Tafsir Ruhul Bayan, an accountant mentioned that Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, he hears the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read this very verse as, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفَسِكُمْ. So this can be read two ways. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ and لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفَسِكُمْ. If you read it as لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ, that means verily there has come to you a prophet from amongst your life, from amongst yourselves. But if you read it as أَنفَس, a siga of ism tafdeel, it means the most valuable one from amongst you. So the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are the most nafis. Anyone who refers to them as Jahannami are the most khabith. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to them as the most nafis. Swiftly moving on inshaAllah to a few ahadith and inshaAllah I'll finish my bayan. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in the Sahih of Imam Muslim's hadith, he mentions, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى كِنَانَةَ مِنْ وَلَدِ إِسْمَعِيلِ. Indeed Allah, verily Allah chose the Banu Kinana from the children of Ismail alayhi salam. وَاصْطَفَى قُرَيْشًا مِنْ كِنَانَةَ. And he chose the Quraysh from Kinana, the Banu Kinana. وَاصْطَفَانِي. And then he chose me, مِنْ بَنِي هَاشِمْ, from the Banu Hashim. So he is making it clear here that my parents are not any ordinary parents. They are chosen parents, chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are pure parents. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, لم يزل الله ينقلني من الأصلاب الطيبة إلى الأرحام الطاهرة مصفى مهذبة، لا تتشعب شعبتان إلا كنت في خيرهما. He mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He continuously transferred me from pure loins to pure wombs, musaffa, muhazzaba, extremely pure, extremely refined. Two groups have never branched out except that I was in the better of the two. Now, لم يزل, this is for istimrar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continuously transferred me. He says, musaffa, muhazzaba. They're both from Bab Taf'il. And Bab Taf'il have the khasa of Mubalagha. So he is emphasizing on the point that I have come from extremely pure loins, extremely pure wounds, extremely refined wounds, extremely refined loins. So for those who refer to the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they should take heed. Because Allah mentions, whoever refers to them as mushrik should take heed. Because Allah mentions, إِنَّمَا الْمُشْرِكُونَ najas. Verily the mushrikun, they are impure. But here Rasulullah is saying, مُصَفَّى مُهَذَّبَ. He's emphasizing. And he says, first he negates, he says, لَا تَتَشَعَّبُوا شُعْبَتَانِ. Two groups have never branched out. Then he brings istisna, إِلَّا. So he's emphasizing it again. This gives the faida of hasar. He's emphasizing, it is me who have been put in the group, in the better of the two groups. This is why he had no brothers and sisters. إِلَّا كُنْتُ فِي خَيْرِهِمَا. So there are three أقوال of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And I finish on this. There are three أقوال of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah regarding the Iman of the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first being that they passed away in the state of fitrah. Fitrah is such an era in which there was no messenger to express his risala and to speak about the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they were within that period. And there's an ijma' ittifaq between all scholars that whoever passes away in such an era will not be punished. وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not punish anyone until he sends a messenger. So they passed away during that phase, therefore they will not be punished. And even if you look at the name, Abdullah, it means the slave of Allah. So whoever named him that, they must have known about the wahdaniyah of Allah. And for him to keep that name, he must have also been satisfied with the wahdaniyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we have Amina, one who has iman. So it does not make sense for someone to say Abdullah, slave of Allah, and at the same time say Aduwullah, the enemy of Allah. Or to say Amina, one who has iman, and then at the same time say she has no iman. It does not make any sense. The second opinion is that the da'wah of Ibrahim alayhi salam could have possibly reached them. So the da'wah of Ibrahim alayhi salam reached them, therefore they died, they passed away as Muslims. Regarding which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, مَا كَانَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ يَهُودِيًا وَلَا نَصْرَانِيًا. That Ibrahim alayhi salam, he's not a Jew, he's not from amongst the Jews, and he's not from amongst the Christians. وَلَكِنْ كَانَ حَنِيفًا مُسْلِمًا. However, he is an upright Muslim. So therefore, they were Muslims due to the da'wah of Ibrahim alayhi salam reaching them. And the final is, and a great amount of scholars, they have agreed to this, major scholars, that the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were brought alive. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made them accept the wahdaniyah of Allah and the risala of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then they passed away. But the question which arises is, if they were already believers, if they were already Muslims and they were sajideen, what was the need of them being brought alive once again? The reason for this was so that they could become sahabi, so that they can become ummati. And there is every time this hadith is mentioned, when from Sahih, from the Sahih of Imam Muslim rahimahullah, sallu ala al habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam. that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, "Ista'adanta Rabbi." He sought permission. He tried to seek permission. Astaghfiru li ummi. Sorry. Ista'adanta Rabbi. He tried. He wants to seek permission to ask for forgiveness for his mother. And then he says, "Falam ya'zan li." I was not permitted. So they use this as an evidence that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he was not permitted to even make a du'a maghfirah for his mother, then how is it that they died as believers? How is it that they died as believers? Now, I would like for us all to reflect on something. When we make a du'a janazah, if you have a doubt in someone's forgiveness, what was the reason in this nahi anil istighfar? If we have a doubt in someone's forgiveness, then we make dua of istighfar for them. Like we say, "Allahumma ighfir li hayyina wa mayyitina," when someone passes away. But when a child passes away, we say, "Waj'alhu lana shafi'an wa mushaffa'a."
Subhanallah.
We make dua for intercession, not forgiveness. Why? Because if someone is already forgiven, there's no need to make a dua for forgiveness.
Subhanallah.
So this is just a logical, this is just a logical approach to the answer, to this hadith. And because this was the last riwayah regarding the iman of the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this makes all the others mansukh. So now they will be believers forever. And they will be ummati and they will be mu'min. I'll just finish up on one final hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions, "Ma bayna bayti wa minbari rawdatun min riyadil jannah." What is in between my home and my minbar is a garden from amongst the gardens of paradise. But why? Because you would pass by five times a day. So then what will be the rank of the womb of that mother who kept Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 9 years? So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to have love for the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the hasideen, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the ability to keep in our minds and hearts what has been said. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me for my mistakes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve Mufti Sahib. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase him in his ilm. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him for coming here whilst being ill. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all for his sake. Ameen. Bihaqqi Taha wa Yasin.